Rosanne Cash is known as a singer-songwriter, as well as being the daughter of Johnny Cash. But what most people don't know is that she's the mother of 5 children and the author of 2 books. She says she'd rather dance than sing. I caught up with her in Boulder, Colorado after a concert to talk about timelessness and tradition.
Blue bedroom, wooden nails, there's nothing left to take. But love and years are not for sale in our old house on the lake.
I have read a lot about you, and I've listened to your music, I've read your books, and I think, wow, you are a woman who has done a lot of living. You've experienced a lot of happiness and a lot of pain. How would you describe yourself today?
I'm 51, and I feel that I've just achieved mastery of what I do, and with that, the attendant confidence that comes with achieving mastery. And I love that. There's no ego boosting that up. It's just that I've been doing this for 30 years and I know what I'm doing, and I feel as if I have a facility with the tools that I use, my voice, guitar, language, that I've been working to get to for my whole life. And at the same time, I feel like a beginner. So it's very exciting. I'm having a great time right now.
Powerful time for you.
Yeah.
Well, you have just released this album, Black Cadillac, mm-hmm. which is the culmination of 2 years' work and 2 years of pain. You lost your dad, your mother, and your stepmother within that time frame. And all the grief and the love and the hope came out in this album, which you've said is really a map of your ancestral yeah. past.
It was a black Cadillac drove you away.
It's a concept record in the purest sense of the word. I wrote the first song 6 weeks before my stepmother died, and I wrote the last song 6 weeks after my mother died. And in that period, I also lost my dad. So these songs and the recording of them was a very contained time in my life that was infused with a lot of grief, just a lot of mourning. But grief is not one thing, you know, and as I started writing the songs, the early songs were dark and full of longing and loss. And as I wrote more, I found a lot of textures that I wasn't expecting, you know, renegotiating the relationship. The relationship goes on, even though the person's out of the body. If you love them, the relationship doesn't end. So how do you refine it for yourself? Because I'm the only one talking now, but yet it still exists. So that was a rich source of material for me emotionally.
Now it's a lonely world. Guess it always was.
What I thought was the most beautiful part for me of all was the ancestry, writing about my personal history. Well, you know, they're deaths and yet everything goes on. So I'm the middle of a story. I'm not the end of a story. Mm-hmm. Where does it begin? And then going back, I went back to the 17th century of my Cash ancestry in this song, The Good Intent. And then my imaginings for the future, what the future generations will do, how we started out as seafarers, and then we became farmers, and then we became musicians, you know. Those transitions were very beautiful and interesting to me. So what happens next?
Well, is that what you meant when you said that songs can be postcards from the future?
Yes. Well, that and also the foreboding. When I wrote Black Cadillac, I wrote it before anyone had died. So, and that was a very dark and foreboding song, so it was
Did you have a premonition?
Yeah, I did. It was alarming. When I wrote that song, I went, oh no. You know, I knew it was a clanging bell from the future.
See those little girls dressed like China dolls, all for one. one, then one by one.
I read that you were brought up mostly by your mother in California, and she was very strict, and you were one of three girls. And
Four girls.
And she gave you a lot to rebel against. So now that you have your own daughters, how do you bring the lessons that you learned from being a child into the present, raising your own kids?
Well, my girls are, for all purposes, grown. So I've already done it. And I can tell you in reflection that I made a lot of mistakes because my mother was very strict. I thought, well, I'm just not going to be that strict. And I went to the opposite extreme, and I was a very liberal parent, you know. And I found out rather quickly that parenting is not a democracy, and that if you try to run it like one,
you lose.
There's a coup. And they came through the tunnel, but my girls rebelled tremendously against me, you know. I thought, oh, I'll just, you know.
And I think it's so painful. I have two daughters, one who is so rebellious, and you take it personally. You think,
absolutely,
I've just done all this stuff. What's the matter with you?
That was the first lesson I learned, actually, when they were around 16, 17, and the hostility and the rebellion. And, you know, I thought, I can't take any of this personally or I'm going down. We'll both go down.
Right.
And so to try to get to an adult, detached place where you can set a limit and let it wash over you, that was very hard for me. And they've come through, you know. They're beautiful young women.
What about your son? He's 7.
Yeah, no rebellion yet, really. Boys, girls are so complicated, you know. And there's so many feelings. And if something happened, you have to trace it back 2 days, 7 people, 6 situations to get to what is actually going on. With boys, it's just like, boom, it's there, it's open, it's in the front, it's very physical. And that's refreshing.
You know, you have these girls who are now grown. Are any of them interested in music? Do they want to follow in the family footsteps? And is that important to you? Do you see a legacy of Cash music? Does it matter to you?
It wouldn't have mattered to me as long as they'd done what they were happy. But now that two of them are in music, one on the business side and one is who's an artist, now it matters. Now I say, oh, I am the middle of a story. You know, I when my daughter Chelsea is a singer-songwriter and she's got a band and she's writing songs, she's quite an amazing songwriter. She's very gothic.
How old is she?
She's 24. She's like a female Leonard Cohen, Southern. She's very particular. And when I started hearing her songs, I felt this surge of relaxation, like, ah, somebody's going to keep doing this. This is great. I can relax, although I haven't yet.
What do you do for fun?
There's, you know, we live in Manhattan, so there's millions of opportunities of things to do with kids.
And I wanted to ask you about that. You grew up in the South and the West Coast, mm-hmm. and here you are raising your child and choosing to live in New York, when on the surface I would think, oh, Rosanne Cash, of course she would live in Nashville or Memphis or somewhere south. Why New York?
People always think that, but I actually grew up in Southern California. I only spent 9 years of my life in Nashville, you know, and I've been in New York for 15 years. So I think that some people are New Yorkers. You know, I just am. I always was. Even before I moved to New York, I was a New Yorker. I feel comfortable there. I love the anonymity that it has bought me. I have a circle of friends who are working at the top of their game as writers, musicians, painters, and that's incredibly inspiring to me. I think it's a great place to raise kids. I raised my girls there, and you know, they couldn't get a driver's license until they were 18. I thought that was fantastic. There's always something to do with them. I love it there.
The woman silent in the mirror tonight wants to talk to your mirror man. And what they really want is love. What they really need is love.
When you graduated from high school, you went out on the road with your dad. What was that experience like, and did it change you?
It did change me. You know, I saw the world, first class, which was great education, mm-hmm. helped me set my standards for the rest of my life.
Thank you, Dad.
Thank you. I don't know if it was such a good thing at the age of 18, though. And I learned all of these songs. And I spent 3 years sitting in the wings watching him perform. And I learned about his essential nature in a way that I couldn't have learned any other way. And that was very important to a teenage girl.
What did you take away from that?
Well, I took away a lot of things. That my dad was timeless in that way that very few artists are. That he belonged to the generations. And it helped me come to terms with missing him, you know, and the fact that he was gone so much, and the fact that the public still thinks that they own Johnny Cash. And in those 3 years on the road with him, I really became more accepting of that, and became even more magnanimous about it. Like, well, I can share him.
But that's a huge, huge lesson. I think of life lessons, and that really would be one of them, because it's very hard to separate your dad from somebody that everybody else thinks they know.
That's right.
Or own. And was he very supportive when you decided you wanted to be a musician?
He was. I think he was a little nervous in the same way my mother was, interestingly enough, about a woman taking on this life and what would happen to the children I would have, you know. They were to say, take care of your children first, you know. Just, you sure you don't want to stay home and hang curtains? And
radio operator in a tiny foreign room.
When did you first realize that you were going to be a musician?
I knew I was going to be a writer from the age of about 8 or 9. And I knew I wanted to write songs when I was about 18. Now, becoming a performer, that took much longer because I didn't really care so much about being a performer. I wanted to be a songwriter.
But you're a writer in the broad sense. You've written a children's book, and you've written a wonderful book of short stories. How is that experience different from songwriting?
It's not that different. I mean, I love songwriting because the structure and the limitations of it are so beautiful to me, that you have this little 3 or 4 minute playground, that you're married to a rhyme scheme, that you set up your internal structure at the beginning and then you have to follow it. There are rules you have to follow. I'm a very structured person, so the discipline of songwriting really appeals to me. It's incredibly satisfying. With prose, there's so much rope to hang yourself and it's scary and fun in that way. But what's interesting to me there too is finding the melody in the prose.
So it's always about the melody.
It's always about the melody.
Well, you wrote these beautiful stories, and one of them about giving birth really talks about giving birth to a child is also like giving birth to yourself.
Yes.
Is that how you feel?
Absolutely. And you continue giving birth to yourself through that child, you know. With each developmental stage that they reach, they teach you something new about yourself. I'm still learning more from my children now than I ever learned from my parents. Can I say that?
You can say that. What about being a parent yourself? Do you find it hard to be an artist and a mother and a parent?
I don't like going to that victim place, like, oh, this is so hard and women have it so much harder. It's not true. I found it challenging. I didn't find very many models. Looking around, I don't see a lot of committed women artists who are also devoted to raising children and doing both well. So that troubled me at first, and I thought, well, there aren't rules about this. This is, you know, there may be a pattern over here. I can certainly create another pattern over here myself. And people say to me a lot, I don't know how you do this. You have 5 children. How do you do this? And you work, you know, you have a full-time job. I say, I don't really know how I do it either, except I know that I operate on instinct, And my instincts have become more refined the older I've gotten, and so I'm doing a better job because the instincts are just, they're getting pretty good, you know?
Fine-tuned.
I mean, there are a couple of standard rules. The little children always come first. Mm-hmm. You know, a seven-year-old or a tour, it's always going to be the seven-year-old.
Absolutely.
There's just no question. A 16-year-old in a tour, 16-year-old can probably handle it if you leave for 2 weeks, you know?
And a lot of people would say, gosh, you're doing all these things. How do you also have time to take care of causes? Where does that passion come from?
It's an extension of mothering. That's absolutely the only, it's the purest reason. Because I have little children and have had little children that are bigger now, and they're going to be around after I'm gone. And if I don't have a sense of stewardship about the earth, how can I teach that to them? Or a sense of that the personal is the social and the social is the personal. I mean, that's something I learned from my dad, is that if you didn't have the courage to speak your own convictions, then you weren't really worth very much. And if, you know, if you got flack for it and there was backlash, then so much the better.
When you walk onto the stage, what are you thinking about, and what do you want the audience to take away with them?
Well, I'm a little more absorbed, self-absorbed than thinking about what I want them to take away. At first, I've got to get in a place where I can get what I want and get out of my own way and let go of the anxiety and the self-consciousness. And then hopefully they get what they came for. They bring their own lives to it. And, you know, I think that that's the best thing that happens in art, is that you see your own life reflected back to you, and that you take something away that's meaningful for you.
When you're sitting down and you're all alone, what do you do to find balance in your own life?
I love yoga. I'm going to have to switch to gentle yoga, I think, so, because I'm getting, I've been doing yoga a long time, though, actually, 15, 16 years.
So you can touch your toes.
Maybe not today. Some days I can. What else do I do? I read quite a lot. You know, I draw dinosaurs with my seven-year-old.
I find it very liberating to look at you, and your eyes are bright, and you talk about your children, and they just shine. And I can feel what a wonderful place you're in, and I think, wow, at some point in life, we all get there at different times. It takes different experiences to get us there. What was that turning point for you that put you into the path that you're following now?
Pain and grief and loss and all of those gifts that don't look like gifts. I had one child that had life-threatening problems, and learning how to mother her had taught me how to take care of myself. And it also made clear to me what unconditional love is. I had a whole different idea of what it was to be a parent until I ran into trouble, you know. And she continues to teach me, and I love her so much. And she, like, that's what I meant when I said that I've learned more from my children than I have from my parents. Because the kind of pain you suffer when your child suffers and when there's something you can't fix, you know, that's just, that will...
That breaks you.
It will break you, and it sends you to God and yourself.
There's a cross above the baby's bed, a savior in her dreams. But she was not delivered then, and the baby became me.
I'd like to ask you about a couple of songs. How about September? September comes.
Well, my father's mortality had kind of been the background noise of my life for 10 years. And he was very ill. And I was dealing with that constant anxiety you deal with when your parent is very sick, and you know it's imminent that you're going to lose them, but these crises come, and then he passes them, and that constant flying down, sitting in hospital rooms, waiting for phone calls, just the tension of it, that was just the background noise. And I was on the Long Island Expressway, we were stuck in traffic, and I was just overcome with that feeling, and I started writing September When It Comes. So I wrote the lyrics, and I had left them lying around, and John found the lyrics, and he wrote the music. He said, can I take these and write the music? Yes, so he wrote this beautiful music for it. And then I recorded it by myself, and John, he said to me for about 3 months, you really should get your dad to sing on this. And I resisted it. I didn't want to use my dad. And then I thought, oh, if there ever was a time and a song, this is it. So I asked him.
And he said yes.
He said, I'll have to read the lyrics first.
And then he said
and then
yes.
He said yes.
I plan to crawl outside these walls, close my eyes and see, and fall into the heart and arms of those who wait for me.
And what was that like recording with your dad?
Oh, that was, he was very sick, you know, and he really wanted to do a good job, and it was very moving.
Is it one of the best experiences you ever had with him?
No, it was too sad. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'll always remember it, and it's a great experience, but...
Poignant, too poignant.
Yeah, too poignant.
What was one of the happier experiences you had, or silly? A side of your relationship that we would never know or see?
Oh, he taught me how to water ski when I was 12. And, you know, I just couldn't get it. He just kept gutting the boat, and... He was so patient, he never said a word. It's like if you fell, he just pulled back around, pick you up, got up. He'd just keep doing it all afternoon until you finally got up. And then when I got up, he'd just whoop and holler, and the glove compartment in the boat flew open, and all of this money flew out. It was a wacky day. He used to make ice cream for us too, snow cream. And set off fireworks in the snow.
That's wonderful.
Yeah, it was great.
Headlights on a Texas road, Hank Williams on the radio, church wedding, they spent all they had. Now the deal is done to become mom and dad.
In your song, I Was Watching You, the last line says, long after life, there's love. Mm.
I believe that that's what survives, that there's something that survives the human body, and it's got to be love. It has to be.
Long after life, there is love.
Do you ever wonder about the choices women have made throughout history? I have some stories for you. Photojournalist Margaret Burke White was one of the most important photographers of the 20th century. On the battlefields of World War II, she was the first woman to be accredited as a war photographer and the first woman authorized to fly on a combat mission. What most people don't know is that this very bold woman saw tranquility as her greatest strength. She said, "I had picked a life that dealt with excitement, tragedy, human triumphs, and suffering. To throw